Hey y'all, this is Dr. Carmen Corder with thedoctornurse.com, and in this video I want to talk about chest tubes. I want to talk about the reasons that they are inserted. I want to talk a little bit about the different parts of the chest tube, the different components, and I want to talk about the nursing care that you have got to know, that you must know for your exams and for NCLEX and for taking care of your patients. So for the most part, chest tubes are inserted to facilitate lung re-expansion when a patient has a pneumothorax or a pleural effusion, right? Where there's either air building up within the pleural space or fluid building up within the pleural space that's preventing full lung expansion. Sometimes you'll also see what we call mediastinal chest tubes that are inserted in the sternal area after CV surgery. And those are inserted to prevent cardiac tamponade, because after CV surgery, fluid is just going to build up there in that area of the incision just as a natural part of the healing process. So the physician, the CV surgeon, will place that mediastinal chest tube to keep that fluid off the heart and off the incision to facilitate healing and actually prevent cardiac tamponade. So those are some of the reasons that you're going to see those chest tubes. Now I want to go right into talking about the different parts of the chest tube. So over here we have the actual tube, and I've got that labeled coming from the patient. So the chest tube is really big. The provider will choose which size chest tube that the patient needs depending on what we're draining, what we're trying to accomplish with the chest tube. But they are large and they are painful going in, right? And at the very tip of the chest tube, you'll see little holes, and that is the part that's going to actually be allowing the air or the fluid to enter the tube and then come down into this part, which I've got labeled the collection chamber. So if your chest tube is being inserted for a pneumo, obviously you're not going to see much by way of drainage in the collection chamber, right? Because you're just pulling off air. Now, upon initial insertion, there might be some initial like serosanguinous type drainage collect in the collection chamber, but nothing other than that. And if you do start seeing a lot of fluid, especially sanguineous fluid, for a pneumothorax, then something is not right and you need to alert the provider to that. But if you're draining a pleural effusion, then whatever shows up in this collection chamber, that's going to be part of your intakes and outputs, all right, that you measure every 12 hours, your eyes and nose. So this is the part where the fluid is going to collect, all right. The next part I want to talk about is this part up here that I've got labeled to suction, and you'll see that this part is connected to what I have labeled as the water seal chamber right here, okay? And it's important that the water seal chamber is maintained at a certain level of water. It's got sterile water, and you're going to maintain that level at 2 centimeters, all right? And so what this water seal chamber does, you'll see that the suction is hooked up here. This water seal chamber creates a place for the air to enter, but not to escape, all right? It's like a one-way valve, all right? If you didn't have this water seal chamber to trap whatever it was that we're trying to drain, then it would just drain right back into the patient, okay? So the water seal chamber is very important. Need to maintain it at 2 centimeters at all times of sterile water. All right, and so this is the actual part that's connected to the wall suction. You'll connect that to what we call the regulator, that big regulator that is on the wall. That regulator is dialed up as far as it'll go. However, your suction, the amount of suction that is applied to the patient, is controlled here by what we call the suction regulator. And this chest tube is a dry system. That is the pleurovac. That's the system that the vast majority of hospitals that I've worked in uses, and so that's the type that I'm going over. But the suction regulator is, it looks like a dial. And the provider will order how much suction to be applied. Usually it's 20 centimeters, okay? So you will dial that suction regulator to 20, even though the tube that's hooked up to the wall is dialed up as far as it'll go. The amount of suction is controlled by this dial right here, the suction regulator, and it's very obvious on the actual chest tube. Now, somewhere around that little suction regulator, you'll see a little, what I call the orange bobby thingy, or the suction monitor, all right? When you see the little orange bobby bouncing and bobbing in that suction monitor window, then your suction is working. Everything's going great, all right? So those are kind of the parts. This right here is just kind of the little tab that stabilizes the chest tube on the ground. There are some handles on the top of the chest tube that will be used if the patient has to be transported anywhere. That kind of sums up the main parts of the chest tube that you need to know about, just kind of the basics, the physiology behind the chest tube. Now I want to talk about some of the assessments and the care. So obviously we're going to be doing some frequent assessments of our patient. All right, so assessment of breath sounds. We're going to be doing that every 2 hours. We're basically going to be assessing everything about the chest tube every 2 hours, okay? Breath sounds every 2 hours. We're going to be looking at the dressing every 2 hours, and the dressing is going to be occlusive, meaning it's going to be like a Vaseline or petroleum gauze. And then you're going to have like an ABD pad over that, all right? So you're going to be assessing that dressing, documenting it as clean, dry, and intact if it is. The other thing you're going to be assessing for every 2 hours is crepitus, and that's also referred to as subcutaneous emphysema. Now I want to mention that, again, this chest tube that is being inserted is huge, all right? Initial insertion will create a certain amount of crepitus, or subcutaneous emphysema. And what that is basically just air leakage up under the skin. And what it feels like is Rice Krispies just crackling and popping under the skin, all right? So upon initial insertion, which 99% of the time happens in the ER, so you're probably not gonna be there for initial insertion unless you're working in the ER setting. But upon initial insertion, that crepitus needs to be marked. And if that crepitus starts to get smaller or doesn't really change any, then it's not a problem. However, it does become a problem if the crepitus that's marked on the dressing begins getting larger and larger and larger and larger, right? That can actually cause respiratory problems. It can occlude the airway. So you need to monitor for that every 2 hours at least, all right? The next things we're going to talk about with the care of the chest tube, the water seal. I've kind of already mentioned about the level of the water seal. It needs to stay at that 2 centimeters or whatever the provider orders, because if your water goes away, then your one-way valve, your drainage system is not going to work, and you can put your patient at risk for all kinds of complications. So you're monitoring the level of the water seal. You're looking at the output in the collection chamber. You're noting, is it serosanguineous? Is it becoming serous? You're noting the amount. Typically over 100 milliliters per hour needs to be reported to the provider, because that can place your patient at risk for hypovolemia and complications like that. Again, provider orders are going to differ according to what we're trying to accomplish with the chest tube, but just as a general rule, any output more than 100 milliliters per hour is kind of a red flag. The drainage, I think I mentioned, you are assessing the appearance of the drainage, all right? A lot of sanguineous drainage is a sign of hemorrhage that needs to be reported, all right? Now, initially, a tad bit of sanguineous drainage upon insertion, that is to be expected, but it's got to turn to serosanguineous fairly quickly. For for us not to become concerned. Bubbling. If you see bubbling in this water seal chamber, that could signal a problem. The key words to remember are intermittent versus continuous. All right. Let's say we are trying to deflate, if you will, a pneumothorax. All right. Every once in a while, you might see some bubbling in this water seal chamber, basically like a burp. Okay. Letting us know that the air is, in fact, coming out of that pleural space. This chest tube is doing its job. We're allowing the lungs to re-expand like they're supposed to. So intermittent bubbling in the water seal chamber is A-OK. Now, continuous bubbling indicates that there is a problem. That indicates that more than likely there is an air leak somewhere along the tube, all right? Either there's a hole poked in the tube somewhere, or there's a hole somewhere inside the tube that's inside the patient, all right? So continuous bubbling in this chamber is a bad sign, and that needs to be investigated further and reported. Tidaling, we want to see tidaling. That means this water seal chamber is going up with inspiration and going down with expiration. That means our connections are good. The tidaling is normal. That's a very good thing. Always, always, always keep the chest tube below the level of the chest, or else whatever is in this collection chamber is going right back into your patient. Milking or stripping. You will sometimes see nurses doing that with their tube. Like, let's say there's some drainage kind of hanging in one of the dependent loops of the chest tube. You might see a nurse milking that drainage to get it down into the collection chamber. Don't do that, because when you milk or strip that chest tube, then you are potentially going to create a tension pneumothorax in your patient. All right, so do not milk or strip the chest tube under any circumstance. Vaseline gauze at the bedside. Now, this is something that's never happened to me in 12 years of nursing practice, and I hope it never happens to you, but just in case, you always have to have a Vaseline or a petroleum occlusive gauze at the bedside of a patient with a chest tube. That is because if this tube comes out of your patient, you've got to cover up that hole with something, and it's got to be something occlusive. So you would take your Vaseline gauze and tape it on three sides, not all four sides, because all you're doing is plugging up that hole and potentially creating a tension pneumothorax. So you want to tape it on three sides to allow air to come out of the hole, but not allow air to come back in. So always, always, always have that Vaseline gauze and tape, paper tape, at the bedside of every patient with a chest tube. You want to have some sterile water, also because you want to make sure that the water seal chamber is always at the level it needs to be. But also, if the tube gets disconnected from the collection, from the chamber itself, if the tube becomes disconnected from the system, in other words, you want to stick it in some sterile water, because that's going to still kind of maintain that one-way valve until you can figure out what needs to be done after that. Clamping, you'll see that every chest tube has a clamp on it. Don't use it. Unless you're directed to by the provider. That clamp is only used under certain circumstances, all right? But it actually can create the same potential for a pneumothorax as stripping or milking that actual tube, all right? So don't clamp your chest tube. All right, so these are the basics that you need to know about the chest tubes. These are things that will come up on respiratory exams. You will be asked these things on the NCLEX. I could think of several select all that apply questions that could come just from this overview of chest tubes. So really try to understand the concepts behind why you don't do certain things, why certain assessments are very important with the chest tubes. And I really hope that this video has helped clear up some of those things for you. If you're watching this from YouTube, head to thedoctornurse.com. I've got tons more videos like this one to help you out with difficult concepts. Subscribe to the YouTube channel. Subscribe to the drnurse.com mailing list. We've got great things happening. And I just want to thank you so, so much for watching this video. And I certainly hope you have learned something from it.